I was raped numerous times by my boyfriend. And the university is aware of that, but he's still back on campus.
Landon Gamble made news last month with that accusation, and now she's facing possible expulsion.
Have you heard about UNC's new department? Probably not. It's not real.
And we have a story about the science of love. You want to stick around for that one?
Carolina Week starts now.
From the UNC School of Journalism and Mass Communication, covering Carolina in HD, this is Carolina Week.
I was raped numerous times by my boyfriend, and the university is aware of that, but he's still back on campus.
Landon Gamble came forward saying she was a victim of sexual assault.
Now the accuser stands accused of intimidation. Good evening, I'm Avery Harper.
And I'm Alex Giles. Almost a month ago, sophomore Landon Gamble accused the university of underreporting sexual assault cases.
She said she was raped by her former boyfriend. Tonight she faces charges from the honor court of intimidating behavior against that former boyfriend.
Last night, a group calling itself UNC Student Power held what it called an emergency meeting. The group was trying to lay out a plan of action to address what it describes as this current injustice. Reporter Kiara Palmer was there and joins us now. Why did the UNC Student Power call for the meeting, Kiara?
Well, Alex, a coalition of student activist groups are trying to get these intimidation charges dropped. They believe Gamble is being victimized twice, once as a victim of sexual assault and now by her peers on the Student Honor Court. Now, the Honor Court says Gamble created a hostile environment for her boyfriend going public. He's still a student at Carolina. However, Gamble told me last night that fewer than 10 people know who he is. Gamble told me she doesn't understand why the Honor Court took this action.
I don't think that I've done anything that is worthy of being charged.
Now, there's a rally of support for Gamble scheduled for this Friday, but the time and location have yet to be decided. I called the Honor Court this office this morning, and the woman who answered the phone would not give me her full name, but she did say that this case could be heard in a couple weeks.
Thank you, Kiara.
The death of Stedman Gage remains a mystery tonight. The UNC junior from Wilmington was found dead in his off-campus residence. Chapel Hill police have not released the cause of death. Gage is the son of former Board of Governors chairwoman Hannah Gage. Gage is the fourth UNC student to die this year. Sophomore Faith Hedgepeth is one of the others. Award-winning Native American band Darkwater Rising is doing what they can to keep her memory alive. They're making a music video to raise awareness for her unsolved murder. The music video has not been released.
Admit it, many of us have done it, but what you may not know is it could go to jail if you do. Fake IDs or using someone else's ID in bars. And local authorities tell me it's happening more and more.
Ben Weeks is a 21-year-old UNC senior from Greensboro. He enjoys going to the bars in Chapel Hill, but he'll tell you himself, he went to some of the same bars when he was younger with a fake ID.
It's definitely awesome. It's kind of a thrill every time you try to go into a bar, just a little rush there, doing something a little illegal, you know, it's entertaining.
Jordan Joseph is a bouncer at Top of the Hill Brewery and Restaurant in Chapel Hill. He says he still sees fake IDs on any given weekend night.
Last night was Thursday night. I'd say roughly last night we got about 10, and that was a slow night. Saturday night, we'll get in between there, about 10 to 20 of them.
Staff at Top of the Hill showed me a stack of confiscated fake ID cards, hundreds thick. They say over the last 2 years, they've seen an increase in people trying to come through this door with fake IDs.
Josh Misamore is a sergeant for the Chapel Hill Police Department. He says the use of fake IDs in Chapel Hill has been consistent.
In the past year, we've arrested or cited 23 people for charges related to fake IDs. Compared to the previous year, it was 24.
Weeks says he used his fake ID roughly 30 times, but only at bars he was confident he could get into. He says his ID was a real one that was passed down to him.
Mine was Louisiana, which thank God no one asked me anything about Louisiana, because that would have been a pretty obvious giveaway there.
Weeks never got his fake ID taken away.
And Sergeant Misamore told us that depending on the circumstances, you are more likely to be charged with a felony if you try to pass off someone else's ID. If convicted, you could face 10 to 13 months of jail. If you're caught with a fake ID, you could be charged with a misdemeanor. That could mean community service or probation for up to 60 days. If you think some of the crosswalks in Chapel Hill are difficult to notice, you're not alone. The town of Chapel Hill is working on a plan to reduce pedestrian accidents by making the crosswalks more visible to those behind the wheel and those crossing the street. Some of the crosswalks around town might have flashing signals installed to reduce accidents. According to Chapel Hill Police, 49 pedestrian accidents occurred between 2010 and 2012. The most recent, a UNC student hit crossing the street at Weaver Dairy Road and MLK Boulevard.
Gender-neutral housing comes to Carolina this fall. That's the plan, anyway. Officials with the UNC Housing Department want to start small. There are 32 spaces in the pilot program. Rooms in Ram Village, Carmichael, and Craig North have been reserved. So far, only 5 returning students have applied for the program. Incoming first-year students still have time. The program allows for students of the opposite sex to room together. Flyers and stickers have popped up all over, suggesting there's a new major on campus, Caucasian Studies. That's right, Caucasian Studies. I looked into what all this is about.
President of the UNC chapter of the NAACP, Chavez Adams, said he was shocked when he saw flyers and stickers around campus for Caucasian Studies courses.
I really was hurt by how someone could actually put those things up.
But Caucasian Studies is not an academic department at UNC. Many of the flyers cross-listed fake Caucasian Studies courses with actual courses at the university, manipulating course descriptions to make it seem more like a Caucasian Studies course.
According to this flyer, this American Studies course is about what it means to be a Caucasian American. But according to the syllabus, it's about Americans of all races.
And we didn't know if it was a hoax or some kind of experiment or some kind of research.
College of Arts and Sciences Communications Director Dee Reed says most of the flyers were taken down.
We didn't want it to confuse people or to offend people.
But many of the stickers and even some of the class flyers are still visible. Adam says he wants to know who's behind it.
To be behind a Caucasian Studies department shows some type of white supremacy.
The motive and people behind the Caucasian Studies hoax is a mystery, and it will probably stay that way. The College of Arts and Sciences is not investigating.
If found, the people behind it all could face honor court charges.
Holding hands can be a booster shot to your relationship.
Find out what science is learning about love next.
Connect with us online by liking the Carolina Week Facebook page and following us on Twitter at Carolina Week UNC.
All right, give me a spot. You know my motto, safety first.
They could be dangerous. I think we should call animal control.
Animal control?
To be safe.
Don't worry. I got this. It's a new motto.
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of teens in foster care who don't need perfection. They need you.
Our health and science team was thinking about love this week, more specifically, the science of love. When you think of love, you might think of romance, but psychologists are looking at love in a different way. Anna Caballo reports.
UNC graduate students Christian Parabek and Bisette Lee got engaged a month ago. They say their love for one another transformed their lives.
Being intentional about loving somebody else is key to maintaining a relationship and to keeping it alive.
You know, we make each other happy and encourage each other, bring out the best in each other, and I think that we really apply that with other people.
That connection with other people lies at the heart of the field of positive psychology. A leading researcher in the field, UNC professor Barbara Fredrickson, says even a smile or a hearty laugh can have positive effects on the body, like relaxation and a sense of well-being. She calls these mini displays of caring micro moments.
Every time we experience a new micro moment, that's like a booster shot to the relationship.
Fredrickson says daily doses of what she calls love's micro moments can add up.
Love doesn't have to like hit you like a lightning bolt and be this most intense experience of your life. The science actually says that these low intensity but frequent positive connections are what matter most.
These connections might be as simple as listening intently, nonverbal gestures, or a nod. They can happen anywhere, anytime, and with anybody.
My guess is that those are the things that happen subconsciously and fly under the radar.
Whether you notice it or not, the exchange of these micro moments can have a ripple effect in your daily life. In Chapel Hill, I'm Ana Cabello.
Well, if you love diet soda, you may be able to drink an extra can of it without worry. A new study from the UNC Gillings School of Public Health says you can drink diet drinks without boosting sugar cravings. The study found no relation between cravings and drinking diet soda. Previous research suggested diet beverages were a trigger for hormones that cause sugar cravings. The study monitored 318 obese adults statewide.
If you work, regardless of how much you make, you'll likely have to file taxes. And some students are facing this task for the first time. Where can they go for help? Jessica Marker has some answers.
UNC senior Lindsay Albright went to the mailbox, as she does every day, and found something she's never seen before.
So the other day, I got a letter in the mail, and it was a W-2, and I really had no idea what that was.
She says she's never been taught how to file taxes and isn't sure what to do.
I feel like filing taxes is one of those things that people expect you to know how to do, but no one ever teaches you how to do it.
Students facing this dilemma don't have to stress. The Compass Center for Women and Families provides a free tax filing service each Monday during tax season.
The center's director of financial education says students can come here not only to have their taxes done for them, but also to have them explained.
One of the goals of the program is to educate the taxpayers about how to complete their own taxes.
And while the title of the center might suggest it provides assistance only to women, Paige says these services are available to everyone.
And of course, women and families is a very inclusive term, and that includes men as well.
Paige says that using the services not only makes filing taxes easier, but also saves you money.
They are trained to find all of those deductions and credits that that you may not know about.
Albright says she wishes she hadn't needed to do research in order to find out about this service.
I had no idea, like, where to go, except for when I researched it online, I finally found something. But they really, like, aren't publicized or on campus. Like, I wish someone had told me that this was here the whole time.
In Chapel Hill, I'm Jessica Marker.
Students and Triangle area community members took part in the 34th annual Minority Health Conference this weekend. This year, the conference focused on helping minorities understand how to use new health care resources through the new Affordable Health Care Act. The conference also emphasized the importance of knowing what resources are available and being proactive when it comes to personal health. Participants included Brian Smedley from the Health Policy Institute in Washington, D.C. The Gillings School of Public Health is working with other organizations across the country to implement these goals.
9/11 changed everything, changed attitudes, and for some, attitudes toward Muslims. Duke and Carolina came together over the weekend to talk about that, especially when it comes to the Muslim veil and the women who wear them. Sefe Amakpai has more.
Aya Zuhri's playing soccer. Notice anything distinctive about her?
I always make sure that my whole body is covered. I will be always covered from, like, the only parts of my body you'll see are my hands, my face, and my feet. That's it.
Women like Zuhri were the main topic discussed at Reorienting the Veil, a conference held at UNC this past weekend. Banu Gokarishkil and Todd Drake talked about different Muslim cultural issues, the balance between fashion and modesty.
When the veil is also a fashion object, it inevitably raises questions about beauty, aesthetics, and distinction.
The harmony between religion and understanding. Todd Drake calls himself a human rights artist and photographer.
The base level theme that I'm trying to get at through all my work is reminding us that we're all human. I think it's all of our inalienable right, every single one of us on the planet, to be considered fully human.
Following his belief, Drake embarked on a series of Muslim self-portraits. Muslim women would express themselves through photo and essay. Drake shared some of their stories.
There's a portrait in this exhibition of a woman from Greensboro. Halona is her first name. She was chased out of school by her peers. She would come to class and sit down. They would get up and move en masse. They would say nasty things behind her back.
Drake, Zuhri, and conference attendees all had the same goal, expand awareness about the covering of an Islamic woman. Zuri had one message in particular.
If you think it's wrong or if you think it's weird and you don't understand it, go ask about it. If anybody approaches me about why I dress the way I dress or what I believe in, I'm more than happy to talk to you about it.
And that's exactly what the purpose of the conference was, provide answers for those very questions. In Chapel Hill, I'm Sefe Amokpai.
CNBC business reporter Kayla Tausche returned to her alma mater for the Women in Media Leadership Series here at the School of Journalism. Students and staff welcomed Tausche into the Halls of Fame room in Carroll Hall, where she spoke about her time at UNC. Her most embarrassing career moment? That came in Ireland when someone poured bourbon on her head right before she was about to go live. The 2008 graduate also talked about her rapid jump to the national cable network. Only 3 years after she graduated from UNC, she joined CNBC as a general reporter. The Women in Media Leadership Series began in January. The next speaker in the series is author Tia McCollars, who is scheduled to visit in April.
We have the story of another graduate from the journalism school tonight as a part of our Black History Month coverage. Reporter Carolyn Chandler has the story of the first African-American woman to graduate from UNC.
Karen Parker loves to travel. She's been to more than 28 countries. These pictures are from Switzerland, this clock from Prague. But her journey started back at UNC when she was the first African-American woman to attend the university in 1963.
And it didn't really mean a lot then, because I had so many issues, so many things I was trying to accomplish then.
Parker participated in protests to desegregate restaurants in Chapel Hill and went to jail several times.
One thing my mother told me, and she said that you have to be on, I had to be on good behavior, because if I didn't behave, they might not want any more of us. I had to set a good example. I didn't want to behave.
It wasn't easy or safe. Parker recalls a time her friends were getting together off campus when the party was interrupted by gunshots.
The Klan shot up the house, shot all the windows out of the house. Fortunately, nobody was hurt. But that was something to remember, you know?
She felt left out at times.
So that was sad. You know, you were not included. That's my biggest regret, I think. But hey, you know, those were the times that, you know, couldn't expect anything more.
After graduation, Parker went on to have a successful career working as a copy editor at several major publications, including the Los Angeles Times. She was inducted into the North Carolina Journalism Hall of Fame in 2012. Parker looks back on her experiences at UNC with fond memories.
And the whole country was kind of riled up, and there was a lot of action. It seemed to be a very exciting time. And now, when I see some documentary or something on back in those days, I really feel proud to have been part of it. It was pretty exciting. It was not dull.
Reporting in Greensboro, I'm Carolyn Chandler.
You can look at Karen Parker's diary from her time at UNC in the Southern Historical Collection at Wilson Library.
What an inspirational story.
Yes, definitely.
Avery, I hope this warm weather sure does stick around.
I do too. Drew Day is with weather next.
Welcome back to Carolina Week, everyone. I'm Drew Day. Thank you so much for staying with us this evening. We're going to go ahead and start off your forecast with the current conditions outside right now at the Horace Williams Airport here in Chapel Hill. The current temperature outside right now is 56 degrees. The dew point's at 35, so the air is much drier today than it was yesterday with all the showers that moved through the area. And the wind is variable at 5 miles per hour, so there's a little bit of a breeze outside right now. As we take a look at the current satellite picture across North Carolina, you can see that we have plenty of sunshine across the area today. There's just some clouds to our south and to our north, but here across the state, we remained dry. And all this cloud cover down to the south is in association with the cold front that moved through across our area yesterday and brought us all those showers. You can see it stretching right down here from the Gulf of Mexico and moving up from the south and west. There's this area of low pressure off to our north and west, but this area of low pressure will move off to the north and east and will move rather innocently and will not affect our weather at all. As we go ahead and take a look at the service map right now, this is a current analysis of what's going on outside. You can see that area of low pressure off to our north, and a little trough is moving through right now, but it's not going to be of any consequence to us. We're going to remain dry here for the next several days. As you can see, by 7 p.m. this evening, again, we remain dry, perhaps a few showers or snowfall in the North Carolina mountains, but again, we will remain dry, and this pattern, again, will continue for the next several days. As you see, Thursday morning, dry across the area as this area of high pressure continues to hang off to our west, and it will certainly keep us dry here for the next several days. So we've had a lot of rain throughout the last several days, and so the dry weather will certainly be moving in, which is certainly some good news for everybody that doesn't like trudging around in the rain back and forth to class all day. As we go ahead and take a look at the forecast for tonight, expect to see partly cloudy skies across the area. Winds 5 to 10 miles per hour. We expect an overnight low of 36 degrees this evening, so very chilly outside. Make sure you have that jacket with you as you head out and about. As we take a look at tomorrow morning, mostly sunny skies, winds 10 to 15 miles per hour with a high of 54 degrees. And with that wind of 10 to 15 miles per hour, it will definitely make it feel cooler than the air temperature outside. So be sure to be aware of that as you head out and about tomorrow. You're definitely going to need your jacket with you. And as we break tomorrow down just a little bit further, a few key time points. Expect by 8 a.m. tomorrow morning, 38 degrees, cloudy skies across the area, but plenty of sunshine will still be able to make it through the area. So it will definitely be sunny tomorrow. 48 degrees by noon. And if you headed out tomorrow evening, expect to see temperatures in the low 40s across the area. And as we take a look at the 5-day forecast, well, today was the last of the warm days, so expect to see temperatures dropping down into the 50s here for highs. Our normal high this time of year is about 60 degrees, so we'll definitely be much cooler for the next several days. So you guys wanted the warm weather to continue? Well, that's not going to happen.
You know, it's still chilly, but we can compromise with the lack of rain.
Yes, it will definitely be beautiful outside from a sunshine standpoint.
Great. Thank you, Drew.
Thanks,
all right,
Drew.
You're welcome.
He might be your local DJ,
but he's no stranger to the spotlight.
G-morning, sunshine. Wakey, wakey. Text me.
I think it might be one in the morning.
Are your parents home later? We can hang. LUV, love you. JK. Holla back. Holla back. Holla back. Are you with your friends? That's lame. We're in a huge fight right now. XO. What'd you dream about?
Something I did.
Are you on your way to the mall?
I'm lonely.
Nude pics. Send me some. Text me.
Carolina Week, I'm Natalia Perez. Reggie Bullock, James Michael McAdoo, and PJ Harrison all should have big games tomorrow night against Clemson. But don't forget about Marcus Page. He's growing up. While he might still look like a freshman, Reggie Bullock says he isn't playing like one.
He's been growing. His confidence is sky high. He feels like he can compete with anybody, and we know that we can compete with anybody. And, you know, he's just going to try to make the best play to help his teammates. And when he gets his feet set, I always feel like his jumper going in. He's a smart point guard.
Page is averaging 13 points and more than 5 assists in his past 3 games. And the basketball team is in action tomorrow, but the top-ranked baseball team's playing right now, taking on St. John's at Bochumer Stadium. The Diamond Heels are up, leading 11-2 in the top of the fifth. And it's not football season yet, but the 2013 Tar Heel football schedule was released this week. 7 home games for the Heels. One of them is a Thursday night game on ESPN. That game will be against Miami October 17th during fall break. Possibly more intriguing, though, are the away games. Opening the season August 29th, the Heels take on South Carolina, playing the Gamecocks in Columbia for the first time since 1990. And the Heels play the Pittsburgh Panthers for the first time as conference foes November 16th. An athlete by day, entertainer by night, almost. Now that soccer season is over, Daniel Tenuse has traded in his jersey and cleats for a turntable. Julian Caldwell reports.
In November, senior Daniel Tenuse enjoyed his last stint with UNC Soccer, but he didn't have to say goodbye to a crowd. He adopted a new one, and he adopted the name DJ Toomey.
Well, the first time ever, you know, performing for anyone, it's just nerve-wracking because, like, there's really nothing that I've ever done before that you know, equates to something like that.
Tanoose downloaded his first DJ software 4 years ago. 2 years ago, he got his first gig here at The Thrill, where he DJs regularly in the off-seasons. He says he likes having control of the crowd.
When you DJ, you have some sort of influence on the crowd, whereas when it comes to soccer, it's really hard to influence the crowd unless you know you're scoring a goal.
As a defender, Tanoose doesn't score many goals, but his teammates are often there to cheer on DJ Toomey.
No, they're definitely my biggest fans, no doubt. You know, they're big supporters of me, and you know, every time I'm DJing, I just know they'll be here.
But what does Tanoose say his biggest celebration has been thus far?
Definitely winning the national championship. You know, it's, you know, there's very few things I think that I'll ever do, you know, maybe or maybe not, that'll ever equate to something like that.
Tanoose is considering options to continue playing soccer, but he isn't limiting himself.
I like to see, you know, what else I can be good at and what else I can succeed in, and hopefully that's where, you know, soccer ends and DJ sort of takes off.
And he has an audience waiting. In Chapel Hill, I'm Julian Caldwell.
Tanoose's former teammates began their spring season this past weekend, falling 1-0 to the Columbus Crew of Major League Soccer in Greensboro. But there was a more recent loss that still haunts both teams. Catherine Fitzgerald has a story.
As a member of the Columbus Crew, former UNC men's soccer player Kirk Urso died of a genetic heart defect. On Sunday, the Heels and the Crew teamed up to play in the inaugural Kirk Urso Memorial Match. Playing an MLS team presented new challenges to the Heels, but the squad has overcome far greater trials.
I mean, it's been a very draining, emotionally forced, just the fact that we lost Kirk. I mean, and we can't change that. Just have to learn to live with it.
Ben Spees, who played with Urso at UNC and with the Crew, is still coping with the loss.
I know him well. Think about him every day, so it's still fresh and it's tough.
Along with recounting memories of Kirk, the Heels and Crew are also focusing on passing on his legacy.
And you know, some people are new to the school and they don't know, you know, who Kirk was or what he was about, and you know, that's actually a really good opportunity for us to tell people how, you know, how he was as a person and also as a player.
It still means a lot because, you know, that we're part of the family here and he was part of the family. So we're doing it for one of our family members.
MLB, 1, 2, 3, baby!
Urso's family members are touched by the outpouring of support they felt.
I want to give a special thanks to the entire Chapel Hill community, UNC, Tar Heels. It's been incredible.
UNC's next move is to unveil a plaque at Fetzer Field memorializing Kirk. In Greensboro, I'm Catherine Fitzgerald.
Thank you, Natalia.
No problem.
These students are preparing to sing and dance their way through a spelling bee.
Find out how you can join in on all the fun next.
If you have a story idea, call Carolina Week at 919-843-8292. Or email us at carolinaweek@unc.edu. And if you have questions about this program, write to us at Carolina Week, Campus Box 3365, UNCCH, Chapel Hill, North Carolina, 27599. Be sure to check out Carolina Week online at carolinaweek.org.
Can you spell Staphylococcus? If so, you might want to try your luck in a spelling bee as Company Carolina presents the 25th annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. The cast members for this comedic musical are hard at work learning songs and dance moves for the show. But cast members aren't the only ones who get to have fun. Each night, select audience members will get up on stage to join kick lines and rounds in the spelling bee. The show opens March 1st at the historic Playmakers Theater. Tickets are available for purchase in advance in the pit or at the Union box office. You can also get your tickets at the door the night of the show. Well, can you spell Staphylococcus, Avery?
I can. That sounds like it's going to be a really great show. That's it for this edition of Carolina Week.
Thank you for watching and have a good night.